Good morning. Welcome to St. Andrew's on this beautiful Sunday morning. We're glad that you are here. Special welcome to those who are worshiping with us for the first time today, those who are new, and a special welcome to those who are watching our live stream. We are glad that you are all with us. Everything you need is in your service booklet. If you don't know what's going on, just look around you and follow what the next person's doing, and it will be fine. Let us take a moment to gather our hearts and minds and prepare for worship. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
There is nature in every spring of your love. There is nature in every spring of your love.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you show your glory throughout your creation, calling it very good. Grant us the fullness of your blessing, that we, stewarding your garden, may become partakers in your joy. Through Jesus Christ, the wisdom of creation, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of Esther. The king and Haman went into feast with Queen Esther on the second day as they were drinking wine. The king again said to Esther, "What is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted to you. And what is your request? Even to half of my kingdom it shall be fulfilled." Then Queen Esther answered, "If I have won your favor, O king, and if it pleases my king, let my life be given to me. That is my petition, and the lives of my people, that is my request. For we have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated. If we had been sold merely as slaves, men and women, I would have held my peace, but no enemy can compensate for this damage to the king." Then King Ahasuerus said to Queen Esther, "Who is he and where is he who has presumed to do this?" Esther said, "A foe and enemy, this wicked Haman." Then Haman was terrified before the king and the queen. Then Harbona, one of the eunuchs in attendance on the king, said, "Look, the very gallows that Haman has prepared for Mordecai, whose word saved the king, stands at Haman's house 50 cubits high." And the king said, "Hang him on that." So they hanged Haman on the gallows and that he had prepared for Mordecai. Then the anger of the king abated. Mordecai recorded these things and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus, both near and far, enjoining them that they should keep the 14th day of the month of Adar and also the 15th day of the same month, year by year, as the days on which the Jews gained relief from their enemies, and as the month that had been turned for them from sorrow into gladness and from mourning into holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days for sending gifts of food to one another and presents to the poor." The word of the Lord. Psalm 124, read responsively. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel now say, if the Lord had not been on our side, then enemies rose up against us. Then would they have swallowed us up alive in their fierce anger towards us? Then would the waters have overwhelmed us and the torrent gone over us? Then would the raging waters have gone right over us? Blessed be the Lord. He has not given us over to be prey for their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
A reading from the Epistle of James. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by one another, by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It's better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Thank you. Let us pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. Well, I said earlier at the 8 o'clock, what a gospel. So I'm going to begin with a story. When I was a child, I would spend my time with my siblings at my grandparents' house each summer. We'd stay there for anywhere from 2 to 4 weeks. They lived up in Vacaville, so it was a relatively short trip from where I grew up in Fremont. I say 2 to 4 weeks because at the end of the second week, we'd ask our Nana and Papa, that's what we'd call our grandparents, if we could stay another week or two. And of course, they always would say yes, even if we were eating them out of house and home. After we got there okay, the negotiation with our mom would begin. We'd call her and practically beg if we could stay another week or two. And usually after some back and forth, our mom would relent and agree to us staying at least another week. During these summers, we'd hear family stories about incredible or unusual or funny things that happened when my grandparents were young. I can recall one time in particular when my grandfather was telling me a story about when my grandparents were newlyweds. My grandmother wanted to surprise him with a homemade lemon meringue pie. Well, she mixed up the salt and the sugar and didn't realize it. I suppose the salt and sugar were stored in similar looking containers, who knows? But anyway, after baking away, she proudly served it to him. Now he could immediately taste what happened, but he didn't let on. He ate the whole slice of pie without a sour face or complaint. He must have been convincing because she cut herself a slice. In the end, he told her what he thought had happened before she took her first bite. Make that clear, before the first bite. So, of course, she asked him why on earth he didn't say anything to her before finishing his whole slice. He replied he loved her. He didn't want to hurt her feelings, and he appreciated whatever she made for him. Now, that's one way to have salt in yourself and be at peace with one another, but I don't think that's what Jesus was advocating for in our gospel lesson for today. Well, last week's gospel ended with one of Jesus' well-known sayings. It goes, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." He said this in response to the disciples arguing about which of them was the greatest. He was expressing that whoever takes on the mantle of humility and service to all is the one who's equipped to lead. Next, we get this little story about the disciples trying to stop someone from exorcising a demon because they were not part of the Jesus movement. This is all part of a larger discourse on structure and parameters, like on boundaries, testing how things run now and will run in the future. It's about finding out who can speak and act on behalf of the movement. And this kind of questioning is not unusual in our time either, right? We want to know how things work, how people are organized, and where they fall in the chain of command in an organization. And in case you didn't notice, all this talk about drawing boundaries and deciding who's in and who's out, it gets Jesus' attention. He uses hyperbole in his response when saying, if your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. If your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. If your eyes cause you to stumble, tear it out. If you put a stumbling block before one of those little ones, it would be better if a great millstone were hung around your neck. He's not being grotesque here. He's relaying the serious nature of this offense. And notice how Jesus says, little ones. You can take that to mean children, of course, but also anyone who is new in their faith, or even newly exploring or re-exploring their faith. If you think about it, little ones actually encompasses a wide range of people. The translation of stumbling block doesn't quite capture what he's saying. It's more than being an obstacle in someone's faith journey and relationship with God. The stumbling block that Jesus is talking about is not about making and enforcing rules, a type of gatekeeping that determines who's in and who's out. He's talking about a type of trauma inflicted on a person that diverts them away from their faith journey, life of discipleship, and relationship with God. The English equivalent word for this stumbling block is scandalize. But in a world filled with scandals, even that loses its meaning for us. At its heart, this really means being so horrified by an experience that you can't remain in the place or go forward on the path where you had that experience. Let that sit with you for a moment. Think of the groups of people that this applies to. Certainly, my mind goes first to our LGBT siblings, but there are many other groups of people that have been harmed in this way. You may even have friends, family, or neighbors that have been hurt like this, and perhaps you don't know it. Can you imagine not being able to step foot in this church, or any church for that matter, because you've been harmed so badly by Christians that you can't fathom the idea of being in a house of worship? And not just going to a church, but not being in a state of mind where you can't even pursue exploring your faith journey, because even that is too traumatic. That's the harm that Jesus is talking about. It's the opposite of hospitality. It's the opposite of welcome. It's the opposite of love and belovedness. Jesus is warning against a scarcity mindset. He's warning us about pride. He's warning us about hate. He's shining a light on the person that says with their words or with their actions, "You aren't welcome here because you're different than me. You don't look like me, talk like me, dress like me, act like me, or believe what I believe. You can't be yourself here because you make me uncomfortable. When I make accommodations for you, that leaves less room for me to do and say what I want to do and say. Your very existence inconveniences me. So go away." In John 13:35, Jesus says, "Everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." Unfortunately, for non-Christians nowadays, that saying seems to be more like, "Everyone will know that you are Christians by your judgment, hypocritical, and unforgiving nature." I didn't make that up. The Episcopal Church conducted a survey in the spring of 2022 that said those were some of the characteristics most closely associated with Christians by non-religious people in the United States. Now, you might say that is other Christian groups that we're that are doing the damage. We say all are welcome, and we mean it. Well, that may be true for us. It doesn't mean that it's true for everyone. What good does it actually do to say all are welcome if we don't actually invite anyone here? What good does it do to say all are welcome, but then qualify it? Only if you like the hymns that I like, or worship like I do, or fit within the box of how I think a Christian should look or should act. And of course, we are the church. This building is not the church, it's just a building. So this applies to our entire lives. You are the church. I am the church. We are the church. We are the church when we go to work or school or at home with our families. We are the church when we are working out at the gym, having lunch with friends, or volunteering to serve others. Anywhere, any place, any time in our lives, we are the church. And it is our sacred obligation to share with others what is life-giving about the good news of the gospel in our words and in our actions each and every day. And Jesus reminds us we're never to harm others in their faith journey, discipleship, and relationship with God. That means we always have to be conscious of what we say and what we do. We don't have to be perfect. I don't mean to say that. No one is perfect. But if we intentionally or unintentionally do harm in this way, we need to seek reconciliation and forgiveness with the person or people we have harmed and own up to what we have done. That's where the part about removing hands and feet and eyes comes in. Jesus is asking us to look inside ourselves and identify what is causing us to stumble as people and as organizations and remove it. Just like we have no place in arguing who is the greatest among us, we don't get to decide who's in and who's out. That's God's work, and I am so glad that the responsibility is not up to me. Rather, our responsibility to one another is to be salty. Not salty in the sense that it has come to mean now, like being angry or bitter or sarcastic, but to live our lives and be disciples in such a way that preserves and enhances our communities and the world. That's what salt does, right? It preserves and it enhances. A little bit of salt goes a long way. This reminds me of our communion bread. Beth's our wonderful baker for today. Just a little bit of salt brings out the sweetness of the honey and the flavor of the wheat. Saltiness, in the way Jesus is talking about, involves being humble in relationships with each other. Like in the simple act my grandfather did for my grandmother with that salty lemon meringue pie. Jesus asks us to be salty in the sense of giving of ourselves for others and reaching out and accepting all people around us. That is how we have salt within ourselves and be at peace with one another. This week, I attended the Changemaker Conference Thursday evening through Saturday morning. As part of worship, one of the leaders read a poem that captures the spirit of this week's lesson. I think it can help us imagine a world where Jesus' teaching is fulfilled, a world filled with unity, love, and praise. This poem is entitled Centering by the Reverend Steve Garnas Holmes. He's a retired United Methodist pastor, and it goes like this. O love, great love, mystery of grace and mercy, we thank you. We are alive because you create us. None is alone. None is forgotten. We are one, and we are gathered, not by our will, but yours. All creation surrounds us. Grasses and trees raise their hands in blessing. Rivers anoint us with grace. Creatures accompany us in praise. The round earth enfolds us. The galaxy dances with us. And we breathe your grace. We are one body, breathing together, a conspiracy of love. You are the life we breathe, the love flowing in our veins. You are the grace that unites us, the spirit in whom we are one body. You are the mindfulness that awakens us, the forgiveness that binds us, the love that moves us. In our hearts, your heart beats. In our gift to you of our silence, you are present. We open ourselves. We listen. We wait. So this week, my ask is that you intentionally bring the salt of Christ that resides within you to all the spaces that you inhabit, both physical and virtual spaces. Preserve and enhance those spaces. Then I'd love to hear from you. Reach out and tell me about your experience. Be salty. Amen.
Please stand if you're able and let us say together the Nicene Creed found on page 7 of your service booklet. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Blessed God, whose love calls the creation into covenant with you, and who puts our hands, responsibility for the care of the earth and its creatures, we pray for all to whom you have given life and being, saying, Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For the well-being of the earth, for its resources of water, air, light, and soil, that they may be tended for the good of all creation, we pray, Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For the mineral and energy resources of the planet, thank you, that we may learn sustainable consumption and sound care of the environment for which they come, we pray, Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For the animals of the earth, wild and domestic, large and small, that we and they may thrive in harmony with one another, we pray. Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For all who shape public policies affecting the planet and its creatures, that they may consider wisely the well-being of all who come after us, we pray. Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace.
For all those engaged in conservation, in agriculture, aquaculture, and fishing, in mining and industry, and in forestry and timber harvesting, that the health, fruitfulness, and beauty of the natural world may be sustained alongside human activity, we pray. Merciful God, sustain people in peace. For the gifts of science and technology, and for those who practice these skills, that they may be wise, visionary, and compassionate in their work, we pray. Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For the creatures and the human beings of this world, of your world, who are ill, are in danger, pain, or special needs, especially Michelle Blom, Pat Brathwaite, Nancy Keene, Sylvia Moore, Lucy Woodbury, Gray Judge, and those who have died, especially Ben Lester Goodman Jr., and those in need of our prayer, now named either silently or aloud. We pray, Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For all who suffer from the unjust, violent, or wasteful use of the earth's resources, or their devastation by war, that we may one day live in communities of justice and peace, we pray. Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For your church, that we, your people, may use our gifts and resources thoughtfully and responsibly, and shine as your light in the world. Thankful for those of your servants who minister to us, we pray. Merciful God, sustain your planet and people in peace. For the creatures and the people of the earth whose lives and deaths have contributed to the fruitful abundance of this planet, we pray. Merciful God, your planet and people in peace.
Gracious God, grant that your people may have in them the same mind that was in Christ Jesus, and guide us into harmony of relationship through loving kindness and the wise use of all that you have given. For you are drawing all things into communion with you and with each other by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And now may the peace of the Lord be always with you. Please greet each other in the name of Christ and speak to someone you do not know. Good morning again. Glad to see you all. Welcome to those who are visiting or who are worshiping with us for the first time, and those who are streaming, watching the live stream. We're glad that you're here. For those who are present, we hope that you will join us over in the Fellowship Cafe, which is in the center, for coffee and a bite to eat after the service. And if you are new, we'd love for you to sign our registry in the narthex so that we can learn something about you and have the opportunity to get to know you. There's also cards, little white cards that the school hasn't crumbled up. The kids do that, you know. The white cards are in there. You can fill one of those out and put it in the plate as well. How many people are wearing name tags? That's what I thought. How many people have name tags? I thought that as well. There is a sheet in the narthex for you to write your name if you do not have a name tag. But there are baskets there. You might want to check and see if you have a name tag in there before you ask for one. But what I would like to ask you to do, although I've been here over a little more than a year, there are a lot of people I still do not know names. And it would help me a great deal if you would wear your name tag on Sunday morning. That would be a good idea. It's also good for anybody. We don't always know everybody's names. People, we know every congregation on any Sunday morning is different than the one before it, because people don't come to church every single Sunday anymore. Very few people do that. So we see new faces. Your name tag would be a big help. So please sign that little clipboard in the narthex, but first check to see if you have one in those baskets. I would appreciate it a great deal. A couple of things. Wednesday night, we have another movie. It is My Octopus Teacher, another documentary that is an absolutely beautiful movie. It also won the Oscar for Best Documentary, and it's part of our creation season movies. We had a good crowd on Wednesday night. Everybody loved the movie, and we met here at 6:30 for evening prayer first, and then have supper and the movie in the center following that. If you would like to join us, please let Joel know so that we have enough food for you. So you don't have to do anything. You just have to show up. You don't have to bring anything. You don't have to cook anything. Just come and enjoy the movie and fellowship. October 6th, that's next Sunday. What's happening? Blessing of the animals, that's right, at 10 o'clock. So please bring your pets if they are happy to come. We probably don't want any pets that are not particularly happy to come. So that's up to you. You can figure that one out. Also, as you walk out the door, we have packets of seeds for you as part of our creation season. Be the change you want to see in the world. And these are wildflowers that help pollinate the bees. Good for the environment, right? So please pick up a package and just sling them in your garden and you will have some beautiful flowers. Also, Joel would like to acknowledge our bread bakers today.
Yeah, so last season of creation, last year, we started having the baked bread for communion, and without really putting out too much of a call for it, we had some volunteers say that they want stand up and say that they wanted to join the team. And so I'd like to recognize our volunteers for this 1 year of service and show a little, give them something for a little show of our appreciation for them. So this is a dough cutter and kind of scraper. And so last year they got aprons, now they're getting dough cutters. And it has a ruler on it so they can actually measure it out to the, we have strict standards, quarter inch, right? So we got these here for you as a token of appreciation. So please, coming up, I think most of them are here. I see Beth, Alan is here, come on up, Elaine.
Don't be bashful if you're
Lauren,
ready for it.
Come on up. Let's give our thanks.
Our bread is really good.
And the bread always comes out tasting really well, so we haven't had any mix-ups of salt and flour, I don't think. So here's for you. Thank you.
We're good mixers. Thank you.
There you go, Beth. Thank you. And we have Judy. Judy also is part of our team. So I have one for her as well. So I'm going to say just a little prayer for our ministry here. And so let us pray. God of mercy, we lift up before you the ministry of bread bakers. Bless those who lead and those who labor on our behalf in this important work. Be present and lead them so that all they do may witness to your love. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's give them another round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's always room for more people to bake if you feel so called to do so. Let Joel know.
Yes, please join us.
Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries this week? Last week we had lots. How about this week? Anybody? Here comes one. Just one? You're the only one. Tell them who you are and what you're celebrating.
My name is Sue Barrera, and I'm celebrating my birthday.
And I think we have a couple that just realized that their anniversary is this week. It happens when you have two children running around, right? Yeah. It was last week. Okay. But, of course. Tell them who you are and what you're celebrating.
Hi, we're Kristen and Patrick Bernhardt, and we celebrated 9 years of marriage last week on September 26th.
Great. Super. All right. If you will turn in your bulletins on page 9, you'll see the birthday prayer. We will pray that first. Let us pray. O God, our times are in your hands. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant as she begins another year. Grant that she may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen her trust in your goodness all the days of her life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And for the anniversary. O God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send, therefore, your blessing upon these, your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Happy anniversary and happy birthday. And now it's time for our offering. Please give generously as God is always generous to us. Walk in love as Christ loved and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice unto God. Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise. Glory to you forever and ever. At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home. By your will, they were created and have their being. From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another. Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight. Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace. By his blood he reconciled us, by his wounds we are healed. And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with you your glory in their unending hymn. Been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our fathers and mothers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God. Everyone is invited to the Lord's table. Please stand if you're able. And let us give thanksgiving for communion. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
And now let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.